and welcome to our Women's Walk with Christ vlog, Speaking Life. My name is Margaret Hilton, and this is my co-host, Kim Turner.
Hello, and happy February to everyone. Hard to believe we're already into the second month of 2021.
The month of love.
Here's a thought that I'm pondering, and you can answer my question too. Do you buy your husband a gift Valentine's Day?
I usually get him a card and sometimes chocolates, but not like a full-on gift.
Okay, we had this discussion this weekend. Why do women always get Valentine's presents and men don't? I'm like, interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't know. Something to think about.
Yeah, just a question to ponder, because that means I do not buy my husband something for Valentine's Day.
Well, maybe this year you can switch it up.
I'll just surprise. Yeah, at least a card.
Well, we have a very special guest for you today. Today we will be talking to Miss Lucy Walsh.
Yay!
And some of you know her. She is one of the original board members of Women's Walk. She has been with the ministry since the beginning, and she helped with the foundation of the ministry. And here she is, Miss Lucy Walsh.
Welcome.
Thank you. How are you?
We're great. How are you today?
I'm okay. I'm okay. Thank you.
Good. It's so nice to see you.
Thank you.
So do you want to start by telling us your mission statement and how you came into Women's Walk?
Well, my mission statement is, as a woman walking with Christ, I co-create a world of peace and acceptance by offering to others my unconditional love and support as I strive to walk the path that Christ has set for me. And I came into Women's Walk with the initial board at the invitation of Judy Holting and Sue Snurbush and Debbie. way back in 2005. And so was in really pretty much from the beginning, not the very initial writing, although Judy and Sue both came to me for some help with some of the segments that they worked on. So it's been a long time, yes. And that was, I didn't ever do a first weekend like, you know, everybody else did, because we did it as the board. And that was a real different experience. So it was a good time. It was a good time for me. I was just looking at retiring the following year. I retired in 2006. So it came at a time when I was free to have all that time to give to the ministry. Mm-hmm. And it filled a need that I had. There was a lot of, what am I going to do? I knew I was ready to be done with working for the school district. And I had done that for 25 years. And it just seemed like a good time to move on. And you know, that when God closes the door, he opens a window, that old saying. And that was really true for me. And I have never looked back. It has been an incredibly growth-filled experience, and met a lot of wonderful, wonderful people, have traveled to some really great places to do weekends. And gosh, we saw the ministry from when we were doing all of our applications by mail, handwritten, mailed out, returned envelopes, send them back. And as soon as we get that, we've got you on a weekend, to, oh my goodness, the technology and all that goes with it have made it so much more convenient and so much easier to focus on the women in the weekend instead of on the day-to-day, you know, oh my gosh, did you get their check? No, I haven't been to the post office box yet, you know, that kind of thing. So yeah, we've really seen it grow, really, really seen it grow from when it was really small. Well, that's kind of a misnomer, isn't it? If you, Kim, maybe you know, and Margaret, it was never small. We always had waiting lists. There was never an empty spot, and it seemed like we just could not do enough weekends.
Wow.
And so, yeah, so that's been good.
Do you ever wish you could go back and actually do the weekend instead of like staffing it and doing it and staffing it and doing it?
No, never did. It would be weird, wouldn't it?
I think it would be hard because you know exactly what's coming, you know?
Yeah. Like,
so I don't know if it would work so well.
But it has certainly changed in that time since you first were working on it, that's for sure.
It has changed a lot. We're a whole lot more in touch with our feminine side on the weekend than we were when we first began. I remember one of the first weekends that we did down outside of Colorado Springs at the Franciscan Center. And there was another retreat going on that weekend. And we had our table set up in one place and they had their table set up in another place, and women were coming up to our table and we would say, "And your name?" Real strict and stern and no social. And we knew these people and they were maybe a little confused, but then every now and again, I'd look over at this other table and they were greeting their women and they had cookies out on platters. And I'm thinking to myself, if I were in this line, I think I might just want to go over to this line and maybe do their weekend. So
I changed my mind.
Yeah. So we've learned a lot. We've learned that women can be brought to the same place that we want them to be, and we can do it in a more loving way. And so that was one of the really big changes that I think we made that probably had a whole lot of impact in a positive way. But early days, you know, we were learning as we went, and everybody's input was valued, and including the lovely ladies that went through those first couple of weekends when we were a little more strict. So it was a good thing.
Didn't scare them too much, Lucy.
Hey, it's all good, right?
Well, we still don't have cookies during check-in, but we might someday. That's something I think we should add.
That's a possibility. You never know.
You just never know.
Although we never lack for food on the weekends, do we?
That's true.
There's an abundance, that's for sure.
That's right.
Yeah.
So. Well, thank you for sharing all that. We appreciate it. So our first question for you this week is, what is your Enneagram number and how does that play out for you?
Well, I'm a six. Am I your first six?
Yes. I think we've had one six, one other six, one other time, but
yeah,
okay.
You're not a two. Usually we have twos on the show.
Twos like to help out. Sixes, not so much. So I am a six and I am a rule follower, and I am very loyal. I like being a six. What I don't like about being a six is that I really like to think that I operate from my heart, but I really operate from my head.
Mm.
And that's what a six does. Everything has to make sense. And you have to make sure all your bases are covered so somebody doesn't come back and say, oh, you know, you didn't do that right. So, but yeah, it's okay to be a six. It's okay to be any of them. You know, the goal is to be whole no matter what your number is. And so That's what we strive for. That's what I strive for. We've done the Enneagram for over 35 years. There were originally six couples, and one of them moved farther up into the mountains. So there were five of us. And at that time, we were all in ministry of one sort or another, either with Engaged Encounter or Marriage Prep or Religious Ed for our church. And just looking for people that we could support and that could support us in our ministries. And so, and that believed in marriage. And so we started meeting once a month on a Sunday evening, and we've done so for 35, going maybe on 40 years, since like 1980, maybe.
Wow.
So we have seen each other through lots of life-changing events, good ones and bad ones. And one of the things that we started studying early was the Enneagram. And Dennis and Judy Holting were big fans of Richard Rohr. And Richard Rohr believed in that. And there was such value in it, in learning about yourself. You know, it wasn't meant to learn how to deal with somebody else, although certainly that can be very helpful. But just to make me know what made me tick. Mm-hmm. And for Jim and I, for my husband and I, not to try and solve the other person, but to know, like, the biggest example for us, I think, is that he's an eight. And so he is very energetic, and he feeds off of other people, and he just loves that energy. And that's how he recharges. And for me, I need the quiet to recharge. You know, I need to be by myself, not always, but too much of something just overwhelms me, and I tend to feel lost. And so for me to sit in the quiet, to lay in the hammock in the summer and just look at the sky and watch the birds go by is kind of a great thing. So it's been helpful in knowing that, so that when I retreat, I don't feel like he thinks I'm being lazy. I know that he understands that I'm recharging. And so, and he also knows that if he's way busy and wanting to go and go and go, there are times when I'll say, oh, you know, I think maybe I'll just stay home this time. Or if I'm going shopping, I think I just want to go by myself today. So, you know, it's a good thing. It's a good tool to use in a relationship, but to use it mostly to learn more about who I am and not try to solve who everybody else is based on their number. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a good thing.
Yeah.
I think that's a great thing. It does. And I know there's parts of mine where sometimes I'm like, oh, I'm not really, is that me? But then when I start to kind of read a little bit more and get more into it, I'm like, oh yeah, I do relate a lot to what's in the nine. I'm like, oh, I want to be the fun one. I want to be the seven or the eight. That's what I want to be. But I'm okay. I'm a nine.
Yeah.
Learning. Yeah.
And I think there are people that don't agree that you can change your personality type. But you don't. You can change how you respond. You can become a healthier two or a healthier nine or a healthier six. Mm-hmm. But at the root of it all, I will always be a six. Right. I will always go to, oh my gosh, what's the worst thing that's going to happen? And then I can logic myself back. And the longer that we have been in it and that I have studied and have become aware, I less and less go to that way extreme place anymore.
Mm.
You know,
so is your wing a five or do you wing seven?
My wing is a two.
Oh, a two.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Okay.
Well, my actual wing, you're right. My actual wing is, I'd love to be a seven. I'd love to be able to laugh, and I'd love to be able to do those kinds of things. But reality is I become more introspective. I'm more of a five.
Okay.
My healthy side is a two.
Okay.
I can see a lot of two in you. You're very, you give to others and in, like in your mission statement, that unconditional, like, what do you need and how can I help you? I see a lot of two in you.
Well, that's what we're here for, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Help so one another.
Yeah. The Enneagram 6 with a 5 wing is often called the defender. And this information that I found about 6s is that 6s are reliable and hardworking and responsible and trustworthy, and they're excellent troubleshooters. They foresee problems and foster cooperation, but they can be defensive, evasive, and anxious.
And we do that to protect ourselves.
Yeah.
But it's true. It's true. It's defending others, defending those that you love, and sometimes to almost an unhealthy place it can be. But I do like being a six. I there's comfort in following the rules, but I do find the older I get that it's a little easier to break the rules depending on what it is. You know, there was a time when if we were out walking and the light said don't walk and there wasn't a car around for miles, I wouldn't walk until the light said walk. Don't do that anymore.
No one has time for that anymore.
Just such a rebel. Oh dear.
That's awesome. Well, thank you for sharing with us about your Enneagram. It's always really interesting to learn how people use it. And like you were talking about using it in your marriage, but it's really just a really good self-reflection tool. So every time we talk about the Enneagram, I just always encourage people, if you don't know your number, then just take the test and find out. And then you can really discover more about yourself and just have better self-awareness about yourself.
And at different points in my life, I'm sure I have been more one way or the other. Because if you're really stressed, if I'm really stressed, I go into a really negative six, and I just get very quiet and very withdrawn and very fearful, very fearful. And when I'm in a healthier place, I can see that negative side and talk myself out of it. So, you know, it's not all bad and it's not all good. And there's no personality that's better than any other. They're just different. They're just different. And we need them all.
Yeah.
And kind of that unhealthy, what you're talking about is kind of like your anti-mission. That's exactly opposite of what your mission is.
Yep, exactly right. Yeah. Easy to become judgmental, and the judgment comes from being hurt as opposed to just feeling like I'm right. You know, it's like if I become wounded, I become very withdrawn and can very easily be the absolute opposite of what I want to be. Fortunately, that doesn't happen a whole lot. So that's a good thing.
That's a good thing. That means you're really healthy.
Working on it. Always a journey.
It is.
Well, that's a good segue into our next question for you of how has God changed your life through Women's Walk?
Wow. Well, he did do that for certain. And he did that by getting me out of myself. Is very challenging in the formation of the ministry in terms of you don't have time to think about. I didn't have time to think about what do I need or what do I want. It was always about what are we doing for the women and how are we going to make this a weekend that changes their lives. How how do we get past the stumbling blocks? And I could not do that if God hadn't said, you know, I think you can do this. I think you have the courage to get out there and speak and share your opinions and share the wisdom that I've given you through all these years. And if you don't do it, if you don't step up and do it, somebody else may, but will they bring the gifts that you bring? And so I think he just made me realize that I can do it because he's there with me, leading me. And I don't know that without Woman's Walk, I'd have reached that point. I think I would have been very content to sit back and not necessarily be the recipient of everybody else's stuff, but just to not offer my gifts. I don't value myself. I don't see the value in myself, or I didn't see the value in myself prior to that. And I think God has probably placed that in front of me and said, wow, look at this, you know, look at what you can do. So he has a way of doing that. You know, I just think that I think I know what's good for me. And a lot of times what I see as good for me is the easy path. And there's not a lot of growth in the easy path. And so struggling, hardship, difficulties all have lessons, and they are all blessings. You just have to know how to find it. And I have been incredibly blessed in my family of origin, in my marriage, with my kids, with ministry, just blessing upon blessing. And to say that comes without hardships, it doesn't. It doesn't. You know, it's like if you're always on the mountaintop, you don't see the glory. You got to get down in the valleys and struggle your way back up and in order to really appreciate what you see when you get to the top. So I think that's what God's taught me in being in the ministry. It's we all have a value, and we just need to figure out where God is leading us, and we have to be open to listening to follow. And I like that. I think I like that. Appreciate it more now that I'm not working. When I have more time raising 5 kids, I didn't always feel like I had a lot of time, that my job was my family, my kids. Yeah. And about the time they were all gone, here came Women's Walk. So, you know, I didn't always work when the kids were really little. I was a stay-at-home mom, and it was my very favorite thing to be.
And you guys had a business, you and Jim had a business, right?
Jim had a business. Okay. Jim, yeah. And I would help him occasionally, but mostly that was his thing. I supported from behind.
You listened to his prompting and stepped out. Because we wouldn't be here today doing our vlog if you didn't.
Yeah, well, that's true. And that's iffy. That's still up for doubt.
No, it's not.
But it definitely has made me more outgoing in it. And he has shown me that I can have confidence in what I have to say and what I have to do. Mm-hmm. And I don't know that without Woman's Walk, I would have reached that point. So that's a good thing.
It is. Okay, our next question is, what is your favorite Women's Walk with Christ agreement?
Oh my gosh. My favorite, my most challenging. The one I like best about myself is the integrity. Mm-hmm. I will do what I say I will do. And I can be counted on. And I think that was one of the things I realized early on with the ministry was if somebody said, okay, this is up to you, you need to do this, I would get it done. And I knew I would get it done to the point, see, there's that negative piece again, to the point where if I knew how I wanted it to go, I have a hard time delegating because I feel like it's going to reflect me. Mm-hmm. And so I know how I want it to be. But the reality is I will get it done. I'm better at delegating. And I like that because it's good to work as a team. But my favorite is the intentionality. Mm-hmm. I just think that that's my mission statement. I seek to live the life that Jesus has set the path for me. Mm-hmm. And I do try to live my life in focus and in mission. And it guides me in conversations. It guides me in activities. Mm. It guides me in how I respond to people. I think that knowing what I want to present myself to be, that intentionality piece helps me to focus on what God wants me to be, mm-hmm. not necessarily what I want me to be. Mm-hmm. And I have not changed a word in my mission statement since the day I wrote it.
Wow.
And it was true for me when I did it. And I still think it's true. I listen to other people's and I think, oh, that's so beautiful. And that's, oh my gosh. And how did they think of that? And mine still rings true. And it's simple enough that I can remember it, number one, but I can remember it because it's what I want it to be.
So you think that's been 15 years you've had that?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing.
It's true. It is so true. I do want peace. That's part of being a six. I do give people the grace and the benefit of the doubt. Sometimes maybe a little more so than what somebody else would, but you know, that's not me. So, I can only be who I am, and I can only be who God created me to be. Mm. And that's what I strive for, you know? And I think Woman's Walk helps me get there. My marriage and our sharing group helps me get there. Jim and I decided, well, when we first got engaged, we had our engagement blessed. And I think there was that understanding early on that we don't do this alone. There's three of us. Mm. There's the two of us and there's God. And as long as we keep him as part of our focus and our relationship, he won't let us down. Doesn't mean he makes our path smooth, but he won't let us down. He will always be there. And that's, again, that piece of intentionality that goes back to this young 20-year-old, you know, newly engaged and just knowing how important God was going to be in our lives. And between that and Woman's Walk, I am a way different person than I was back then. And I hope to think I'm a better person than I was way back then. I'm certainly less self-focused. I am more other-focused. And I like that. I like that part of the two of me, Margaret, that likes to do for people mm-hmm. and be there for people. Mm-hmm. And not to get anything back, but just for the joy of being able to do it. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it is, all of our agreements are great. And I know at different days, different weeks, different ones appeal, but those two are always strong for me, the integrity and the intentionality. Mm-hmm. So that's a good thing. It's a good place to be. Woman's Walk is a great place to be.
It is. It's a wonderful place to be.
When you were talking about being yourself, and it made me think of a quote by Oscar Wilde. And he says, be yourself because everyone else is already taken.
Yeah. Oh, that's a good one.
So simple, yet so true.
Yes. Yes.
That is true.
Well, if you're not yourself, you're not authentic, right?
Yeah. Yet another agreement.
Another agreement. So
very good. Okay, so what are some of your daily or weekly spiritual practices?
I like that. When I was young and raising my family, it didn't seem like I had a whole lot of time for spiritual practice. The going to church on Sundays, that was always a biggie. But after I retired, and I found I had more time for Bible reading, for prayer, for meditation. This might sound silly, but I am Catholic. That's not the silly part. But as Catholics, growing up, we were taught about reading the Bible. You know, you got the Bible readings, you got the scripture readings every Sunday at Mass. But in terms of being encouraged to read the Bible when I was growing up, that wasn't a done thing. And then after we got married and we moved here, because we traveled a lot, and our pastor was Monsignor Ken Leone, although he was Father Ken at the time, and he was our pastor. And one of the things that he said that really got me into Bible reading was, take a marker, a highlighter, and go through your New Testament and highlight just the words that Jesus spoke. Mm. That changed my whole perspective on reading the Bible. Mm-hmm. It was like, oh my goodness. You know, all the rest, and the two major ones that just always have gotten me is the Ten Commandments, you know, love God, love your neighbor. If you do those two things, you really don't need the rest of them because, you know, you won't hurt them. You won't steal from them. You won't, you just don't if you just follow those two. And so I like to read the Bible, and I have a woman's devotional Bible that I really enjoy. And it has lots of readings, writings from women scholars, women scripture scholars. I say the rosary a lot. That is probably my go-to prayer. And it really is more of a meditation than just a series of Our Fathers and Hail Marys. It's a meditative time. And then I have a book that I read called Words of Grace, and it's meditations for the day. Yeah, those three things I think are my biggest.
Those are some good practices to have.
I could easily spend a whole lot of time meditating and praying, and that could be a cop out from not actually getting out and doing.
Right. So, yeah. I gotta keep praying.
Yes, it's like that faith without works, you know, you got to do both.
Well, and you know that Kim and I are very musical. We're kind of concert junkies. We love the music, and we named our show after one of our favorite Toby Mac songs. And I think it was a DC Talk song when you were talking about highlighting everything Jesus said. It's a song called Red Letters, In the Red Letters. It's just a beautiful, and like watching the music video, you know, just watching just the red letters, because in some Bibles, you know, what everything Jesus spoke was in the red letters. So it's just a beautiful picture of reading. Mm-hmm. I love that.
That's a good way, like you said, to get yourself into the Bible, because I myself was raised Catholic, the same thing. And we only really did the New Testament, and we only really heard it on Sundays, and that was about it. Like, they didn't teach it in school or anything. So
no,
I'm like kindergartner, you know, I'm still learning all the different parts of the Bible, which I love, because I don't even know that we even cracked open the Old Testament in school or anything after. And so it's all new for me still, which I love. So it's just a new practice for me too.
Well, and then not only that, Kim, if you look at the fact that because of the age that I'm at, it was back in the day when the Mass was always in Latin. And so, you know, even if they prayed those prayers, I knew the responses, you know, I can respond back in Latin, but do I understand it? Not so much. So, you know, and the Bible it's beautiful. There's just the books of wisdom and the Psalms and just so much written as a life pattern, as a guide, that you really don't need a whole lot else.
And if you're questioning, I mean, you can type it in Google and it will tell you a Bible verse that'll answer that question for you. It's like there's everything is there in this one book, all the answers you need. And it's amazing. Yep. I love doing that. Yeah.
And again, I come back to the two: love God, love your neighbor. Yeah. You do those two things and you just can't go wrong. So,
as our dear friend Rhonda White says, I highly recommend it.
Yes. In just that tone, right?
Yes.
I highly recommend the Bible. You should read it.
She's so wise, isn't she?
Yes.
Okay, so our last question is, fill in this statement. God is... Who is God to you?
Oh, God is the guiding force of my life. He's the purpose for my being. Mm-hmm. He is Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He is all-encompassing. He's the reason I'm here. He is the reason that I got married. He is the reason that we had children to give honor and glory to him. He gives my life purpose. It makes me sad when I think about the fact that a lot of people don't believe in God. I can't imagine how I would live my life without him if I didn't have him to lean on in the hard times. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is my purpose for being. I don't think I can say any more than that. And I believe in the Trinity. I believe in the Father. I believe in Jesus, and the Holy Spirit is my conscience. He's my guide. That's a powerful question that we could stand to ask ourselves more often, isn't it?
Because I think it changes sometimes, you know, in your season. What season are you in? What does he mean to you at that point? And in different times and I'm sure it'd be different for you now than if you would have been asked that question when you and Jim were just getting engaged. could have been a totally different answer. Yeah. So I think, yeah, we should check in with that every now and then of who is God to me at this point in my life.
Yeah.
That's a great question, Margaret.
Oh, I thank you very much.
It is a good question. Oh.
Not well, a lot of people pick that question. We've only
I'm glad you picked it.
We tried to throw in a couple of hard ones every now and then.
Well, they could all be hard if you didn't have much of a faith life, couldn't they?
They could be.
Very true. That is a perfect segue, since we're already laughing, to go into our FFFFs, which is our funny fuel for Fridays. As you know, our show drops on Thursdays, and so a lot of you watch it on Fridays or on the weekend, and so we just want to start your weekend off with some funnies. So these are your favorites, or some of your funny stories about yourself. So our first fa-fa-fa-fa is, what is your favorite meal? It can be breakfast, lunch, or dinner. And is it from a restaurant or homemade?
Well, I like to cook, but my favorite meal is one that somebody else does for me where I don't have to clean up the dishes.
I like it.
I like it. I love seafood. Mm. We like Roy's in Hawaii is one of our favorite places to go when we go there. Mm. One of our first trips, I think it was our very first trip to Hawaii, we used to laugh at the fact that being Catholic and we didn't eat meat on Fridays when we were growing up, that was the tradition and the ritual. And Jim and I always used to say, this isn't a hardship for us because we love seafood. We could eat seafood every day and never get tired of it until we went to Hawaii and we had seafood till it was coming out of our ears. And one day we'd been there for maybe, I don't know, a week and a half or so. And we decided we just needed something spicy. We just were craving. So we found a place that sold pizza. And we ordered pizza, but we ordered a shrimp cocktail. And they brought the shrimp cocktail in this huge goblet. And it was all packed with ice. And the shrimp were all tucked into the ice. And so as we were eating the shrimp, we were putting the tails back into the ice. And at one point, our waitress came by and she said, is there something wrong with the shrimp cocktail? And we said, no, why? She said, well, you're not eating it. And we said, oh, yes. And we were pulling all the tails out. And we were just laughing because it was like, well, we needed something spicy, but we still got to have the seafood. So.
Well, and it's hard to get here in Colorado, good fresh seafood. So you got to get it away.
It is.
Okay, our next Papa Papa is, what is your best or worst movie you have ever seen?
Best movie. I'm not a whole lot of a movie person. I love musicals, however.
That's good.
Loved The Sound of Music, loved the music for Mary Poppins. Yeah, I just think I look at music and movies as entertainment to get me away from real life. So I'm not really into the war movies, although there are some that are really good that I enjoy. I want to be entertained, and musicals do that for me. Music fills my soul. I wish I had a better voice. I don't, but in my head, I sound really good.
I do.
So I like musicals. I'm probably more into books than I am movies.
I love musicals. I'm so sad we haven't been able to go and see one.
Yeah.
It's always one of my favorite things that I get to do with my boys. I always give them for Christmas, them and their significant others, tickets to whatever musicals are coming, and we go as a family. I miss that.
I know.
It's not the same to watch it on TV. Like, live is just amazing.
Oh my gosh, when Sound of Music first came out, we were living in just outside of Minneapolis. And it was when Panavision first came in, and it was this great big thing. And we went up to Minneapolis and saw it on this huge screen, and it was so amazing. Mm-hmm. You just felt like you were right there on the mountaintop with Julie Andrews, you know?
The hills are alive.
I know. So that was one of our great joys in being in the ministry, was having the opportunity to go to Austria and to visit some of those places where The Sound of Music was filmed.
Yeah.
And a little disappointing to hear the backstory. Austria wasn't as in love with Julie Andrews as we all were.
Right. It's like, oh, we don't want to know that part.
Exactly.
Yeah. That was a really funny realization that we were all like, so like, let's go on the tour. And they're like, really? That's what you want to do? Like,
Yeah, they really couldn't have gone over that mountain, because that would have taken them. No, that wouldn't have worked, you know, but yeah, I love musicals. They're my favorite kinds of movies.
Mm-hmm. That's a good one.
Good. Okay, what is the most fun thing you've done during the pandemic or during quarantine?
Has anybody done anything fun during the pandemic and quarantine?
You have to be creative.
Well, when it first broke out, we were in Kentucky and heading to Michigan before coming back here. And so our season with baseball and gymnastics that we always go back to Kentucky for, and then a trip back to Michigan home, was cut short by the pandemic. So, excuse me. So probably the most fun thing we did was in November, we went down to Arizona. One of our daughters has a house there. It's a rental property that they purchased and built. And we went and spent some time there. And that was lovely. We had great weather. They have a pool in the backyard and a hot tub. And it just was kind of a break from not being able to see people and not being able to do things, because when we're on vacation, we're just with us. So you didn't miss not seeing other people. So that's probably the most fun thing that we did. And we're just looking forward to getting back to some kind of a normal life. And Rockies and travel and all those fun things. It'll happen.
It's going to happen. I believe it.
Well, one of the most fun things I've done was with you when your grandson was playing baseball. You invited us to come and watch.
Yes.
And it was outside, so it was safe. And we were at a baseball game.
Gosh. Oh my gosh, Margaret. I'd forgotten that.
That was really
cool. Yes. Thank you. That was so cool that you guys came down. We love watching our grandkids in their sports. So
it's fun.
Always fun. Always fun.
Mm. Okay, so the last question is, if you didn't have to worry about making a living, what would your dream job be and why?
Wow. Well, God has blessed me in lots of ways, and I never really did have to worry about making a living. Jim mm-hmm. took and does take good care of us. Which allowed me to do my green job, which was to be a mom. Mm-hmm. We have 5 kids, and they were from 9 to newborn. So every other year or so, we were having a baby. And I absolutely love that. That was what I'd always wanted to do. But if I had to have a paying job, it probably would be in the nursing field. Mm-hmm. There's just something about being able to help people, and probably my dream area would be maybe neonatal mm-hmm. or delivery, just something to do with babies. Just love those babies. I love the smell of them. I love the way they feel. I love how teeny tiny they are and how they respond. And so if I had to work, that would be it.
That would be it. That's a good
that
job.
Would be it.
I love babies. With the babies.
Yeah. They're fresh and they're new and their lives are just beginning. It's beautiful. I love babies.
I know. And they have a fragrance about them that's like nothing else on earth.
Mm-mm. It's not. And you can't really explain it. It's just,
no.
I don't know for you, but all of mine were a little bit different. Like there was just something different about each one.
Yep, they were. They were. And there's just that something in my soul that relates to them. When our oldest granddaughter was born, and she just turned 24, and they were living in Littleton, and we were here, I would leave work, and I would call Lori, and I'd say, are you doing anything? I just need to come hold her. I just need to get that Lori fix, that baby fix, you know? And so I would drive half hour down to Littleton to spend a few minutes with her and then back home to make dinner for the kids, the rest of the family. And they are precious. They truly are God's belief that the world is a good place.
I love that.
Yeah, it's good. Life is good, right?
It you is.
And all life is good.
You probably have some great grandchildren in your future too, yeah?
We already have several.
Oh, great grandchildren.
Great grandchildren. Yes, ma'am.
Wow.
We have four.
Oh my gosh.
I didn't realize that.
Yep.
So, that's exciting.
Yeah, that's exciting. We don't see them very often. They don't live close by. And they are step grandchildren, so they're step great grandchildren, but they're still family.
Yeah,
that's right. How exciting.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm old. Just old.
Don't look old.
No, you're vintage. That's
oh, okay. Oh, goodness gracious.
Which is vintage. That's a good word.
That is a good word.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Lucy. We really appreciate it. We love spending time with you.
Well, thank you for asking. And hopefully we'll be together soon.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah. Margaret and I were just talking about that. We're still praying that we get to have April. So hopefully that works out.
Yes, that would be great. All right. Love you guys.
Love you too. Thanks, Lucy.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Bye. I love her.
Right. I was just going to say, I love Lucy. Silly, but it's true.
I love Lucy.
Love Lucy.
When she's a Lucille, her husband calls her Lucille.
Oh, is she really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
I love what she was saying about her spiritual practices and then just about the agreements. And then when she was saying about how she used to follow the rules so carefully and now it's okay to walk when the little sign doesn't walk.
Wow, she's really a rule breaker.
Living wild. But I think it's so true. I think sometimes like I'm like that, like I can just take the rules so seriously and take myself too seriously. And just to know that sometimes it's okay to walk, even though it says don't walk, and it's still going to be okay. It's still going to be safe.
Cause that leads you to trusting that it's going to be okay. Right.
Indeed. So yes. Very good.
I really loved her answers and thoughts on who God is. I thought that was beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, that is something I should really ponder right now. Like, where in my life right now, who is he to me? And what does that look like?
Someday I'll have to interview you again when it's not Christmas. I'll have to do the regular question interviews.
Right. We'll have to do we'll be our own guests.
We'll be the guests of the show.
And now we're to our faith fuel for Friday. So this week, it is, which kind of leads to, ties with a lot of what Lucy was kind of talking about. So
there's a lot of foreshadowing going on.
Right? I was
didn't
like,
even know it.
Gave it to me the other day. I was like, this is okay. This is the verse. All right. So it is 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9, and I'm going to read it from the New Living Translation. And it says, each time he said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in your weakness. So now I'm glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. So for me, this verse really came to me because I have really been struggling with all of my weaknesses and my weaknesses in my left hand. And I focus on them so much that I never really get to see the right hand because this outweighs so much. And I never see the good in my left hand. And so I really had to take myself to some quiet and some peace and fill and look at the left hand. But then I had to give it to God and trust him with all of those, and that there are gifts in all of those weaknesses. There's gifts in my lack of self-confidence, and there's gifts in my so many. I could go on for hours, but there's just so much. But if I trust him, I know that he's going to be there too. And I know it's hard to see those sometimes. And so I really want to focus on that, that there are these weaknesses, but there's gifts in them. And so now I'm going to focus on filling this hand with what are the gifts that I get from that? And what are the strengths that God gives me through those?
Mm-hmm.
And so I just, it's going to take a while. And I know it'll be some work that I'll have to keep doing in spirit circle because it's so easy to focus on this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I could keep this in front of me all the time and never look at these, but I have to see both of them at some point, you know, because that's who my purpose in life is, to be both in the world, to take both my gifts and my weaknesses and use them for his good and his glory. And so I'm hoping and I'm striving to be able to do that so that I can see that, so that I can see Christ through me.
Well, I think that really speaks to your humility too, because in humility isn't about just like being level with the good stuff, it's being level with the not so good stuff too. So it's not like your left hand is way up here and your giftedness, that's not humility. And it's not humility this way too, if your gifts are way up here and or way back here, like you're hiding, you know, whatever is in your left hand, the perfect balance and the unity to be able to have humility is both hands right out in front of you.
Yeah. Like I say, sometimes it does. This will be a little bit more, but when it gets like this is when it's not.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there are just some days when I'm just feeling better about myself and days when I'm really not. And I can keep them in check.
Yeah. So it's interesting because the message version, the one I have, says, my grace is enough. It's all you need. My strength comes into its own in your weakness. Once I heard that, I was glad to let it happen. I quit focusing on the handicap and began appreciating the gift.
Ooh, I love that. I like how it's different, but really the same, just a little more today.
Yeah.
In the passage. Yeah. Oh, I love that.
Like we say, that's how Toby would say it.
Right. It's the Toby Max spiced up version.
Toby version.
Yay. Okay. So now it's time for our G walking.
God and on the ground.
Margaret is going to share with us this week.
So for the past 5 weeks now, I have been doing this study. And I've talked about it a couple times on the vlog and just with you. And I talk about it all the time just because it's so impactful. But I have been getting up early. The working from home has allowed me to sleep a little bit later. And sometimes I would sleep until 6:45 and then get on my computer at 7. But just getting more sleep has allowed me to be able to just feel more rested. And so when I started doing this study, I started getting up at 6 a.m. Every day. And then on the weekends, I kind of just do it whenever I want. But it's just such a beautiful way to start my day. And it's just God is showing me so many valuable things through this study. And it's a study, like I said, I've talked about it before. It's by Angie Smith, called Matchless. And it's about the life and love of Jesus. And she just has a beautiful way of taking pieces of the Old Testament. She starts in the Old Testament, and just so we have a base understanding, and then bringing it into the New Testament and seeing how things compare, and how, you know, Jesus didn't come to abolish the Old Testament laws. He came to fulfill the prophecy, you know, and that, so there's a new covenant, but that doesn't mean we just completely throw out the old. And just, you know, like I was reading last night about the how when Jesus turned the water into wine. And she's very, Angie is just very down to earth. And she's just like, just before we dig into it, just write down anything that you know and anything you remember. And there's no, you know, there's no points. It doesn't matter, you know, like just write down anything you know, and then we'll learn more about it, you know. And I couldn't really remember that much about that story. But after digging into it, you know, it was Jesus's first miracle. And he did it at a wedding, and he was invited to the wedding because his mother was there, and just all these little details that it's like, it all matters. It all means something. And she's just really good about drawing it out and showing the comparisons and the connections. And I've just had so many aha moments, like, oh, I didn't know that, or wow, that's just so awesome, you know? So.
And how long of a study is it?
It's an 8-week study.
8-week study. Okay.
So I'm about halfway through, and moving into the fifth week. There's a video every Thursday that she posts, and I'm doing it with a bunch of other people online. And then you study every day by yourself. And there's just different questions. And it takes me about 30, 45 minutes, but it's just so, so good. And I've just learned so much. And it's really, God had me do it right now, for very pointed reasons, you know, like he led me to this specific study just right now. And it's just been really, it's speaking life into my day, every day.
Oh, Toby. Awesome. How did you find out about it?
So I've been wanting to do a study for a long time. For those of you who don't know, I'm in school. I'm going to get my bachelor's degree in applied social sciences and a sociology degree. And I'm not taking a class right now. And so I thought, well, instead of just taking a total break and not doing any kind of study, I'll do a Bible study. So I found it on the Lifeway website, and it's just been so fantastic.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah. So God shows up in that study for me every day.
That's awesome. Well, yeah. Check it out. Recommended by Margaret.
I definitely recommend it. I highly recommend it, as Rhonda would say. You know, and what's funny about that is I think when we were talking about that, when she was on the show, she said she was talking about guacamole. I highly recommend it.
Because who doesn't eat guacamole? She's so funny.
So funny.
Well, thank you for sharing that, Margaret.
Absolutely. And we thank all of you for tuning in and watching another episode of our show. And we just, I say it every time, but we're just so grateful for your love and for your support. And if you're watching, give us a thumbs up or a comment about something that Lucy said that you really liked, and let us know that you're here. And if you have any ideas for future shows, or if you have a G-walking story that you'd like for us to share, shoot us an email. My email is margaret@womenswalkwithchrist.org, and Kim's email is kim@womenswalkwithchrist.org.
Yes, so please shoot us your stories. We would love to share them on our show. And when you're sharing them, do let us know that it is okay for us to share them on the show before we do that, because we do have confidentiality. Another agreement. So I hope you all have a wonderful and blessed next couple of weeks, and a happy Valentine's Day, and we'll see you soon.
Yeah.
Bless you.
Bless you.